Hi, good afternoon.
Hi,
Hi, good
good
afternoon.
afternoon.
How are
Yeah,
you?
we are good.
Good.
We thought about time difference and all
Yes.
that, but it has started. We were just warming up, waiting for you.
Okay.
I think you've been made a co-host, so you can do
Okay.
a few things. And I would like to introduce you, but I'm sure you'll say more about yourself,
Thank you so
just a
much.
little bit. We were hoping that Dr. Mohammed would be here, but I can't see him in the hall. But yeah, so welcome everybody. We are so excited, actually, you're here. You have no idea.
Thank you so much. Excuse me. I thought my presentation it will start after around 40 minutes. I am
That's
sorry.
about time differences.
Oh, yeah, I am
Yeah,
sorry. Okay.
that's
Okay.
okay. So everyone, this is Zuhair Claif. He's a lecturer, Faculty of Humanities and Educational Science, and a researcher in Artificial Intelligence and Virtual Reality Research Center at the An-Najah National University in Palestine. So he's going to tell us more about himself, and we acknowledge what is going on in Palestine at the moment, and we empathize with everything, and we hope that the animosity can stop. But I'm handing over to you to take us through the session. So thank you for being here, everyone, and thank you to you.
Okay.
Over to you, Sir.
Okay. Thank you so much for all of you for attending this session. I am Zuhair Najuchlaif, Assistant Professor at An-Najah National University in Instructional Design Educational Technology. My research interest located in artificial intelligence or in general about using emerging technology in education in order to mitigate the difficulties that our educational system is facing due to conflict and unstable situation. In general, to be honest, to talk about my experience about using educational technology, we use it almost in schools and for professional development of teachers. Before the war on Gaza, we were training teachers from West Bank about using technology in order to exchange our experience, to exchange our knowledge and skill about curriculum development between Gaza and West Bank just by using technology, by using Zoom or by using other video conferencing platforms. I am happy to have about this presentation, which is talking in general about using artificial intelligence, specifically about generative AI in education. I will talk about my topic will be about practical issues more than theoretical or general discussion. What I will talk about is how we use it, artificial intelligence or specifically generative AI, artificial intelligence in education to mitigate the difficulties that we have due to the war, due to the unstable situation, due to the conflict zone, what we have in order to mitigate this issue, in order to have a professional development of with our teachers. For example, in the last month, we were using generative AI in order to support our kids and our teachers in Gaza by using some tools or some applications in order to have emotional support for the students, in order to have like emotionally supporting them. In addition to that, because of the closing of the universities and the schools in some areas in West Bank, we are using it in order to develop curriculum, specifically using Canva, which is supported by AI in order to produce, to have high interactive content. This is why I will talk about it in general, okay? I hope that you are understanding what I'm saying, because maybe the language is not strong. Okay. So in order to have like a brief discussion about generative AI and its type, it is like a new type of artificial intelligence, which is focusing about generating text, transferring text into video And this is important. We use a lot in order to support our curriculum. In order to that, transferring the text into audio. In addition to that, using it in order to synthetic of the data in general. So it is easy for us. This is like a general definitions of using generative AI. In addition to that, there is like a new trend about using AI, specifically after UNESCO released its international guidelines for using generative AI in education and research, which is more focusing about how can we use generative AI in education and in scientific research. In general, to be honest, when we are talking about faculty member in higher education, we have three things that we have to do in our daily task and our daily job, which is related to teaching, related to scientific research in order to publish articles, which is improving the university's rank and to have more productivity about scientific research. In addition to that, to the services that we are providing for our students and for our community in general. So how can generative AI support faculty members in three areas or three main domains that we have to focus more about in our daily tasks in general? Okay. Now, talking about teaching, it is related to, first of all, it is related to content creation and content curation, which is mean that improving an existing content or creating a content from scratch. We are using some tools that I will talk later about these tools. In addition to that, using grading and feedback, specifically using GradScope in order to grade the students and to grade the handwriting assignments for the students. Yes?
Are your slides supposed to be moving or you're still on the first one?
No, oh, sorry. No, it should move. It should move.
They have not moved since.
Okay, sorry. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
We appreciate.
Okay. So, yeah, this is the slide that we are talking about, the three areas or three domains that we are working.
Sorry, can you put in the mode show?
Mode show, okay. Or I can share, which is called share the screen. I think it will be good. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Do you see now is my screen now?
Yes, now it's
excellent.
Much better. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Now it is moved to the another screen, right?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you so much. So yeah, so about the fields of using teaching, how can we utilize generative AI in teaching? It has around nine domains or fields that we can utilize it. It was started by content creation, which means that establish or create interactive content by using specific tools, not only ChatGPT 3.5 or ChatGPT 4, but we are using Canva, which is supported AI. Using also grading and feedback in order to grade handwriting assignments for students or design your research or test assessment for students and for faculty members for assess evaluation of the professional development programs using GradScope and using ChatGPT 4. And for personalized learning, which is specifically for special education, we are using it in order to support our teachers and pre-service teachers in special education. Then going to tutoring and help students, inclusive education, which is including how we can achieve the equity in education between the genders, between the managerial areas, design the courses and teaching assistance, data analysis and learning language. So I will start by content creations. Just this is like an abul, just we are conducting a research. If you are interested to answer my question, I will appreciate it in order to know what type of applications you are using in your teaching, specifically who are our colleagues teaching in higher education institutions in any country in general. Okay, now about the content creation, just in order to have, we have a four types, which is related to visual, using image generators, especially using in nursing educations, Midjourney, in order how we can establish some images in order to present for students for specific tasks. We use it in nursing educations. A video generator using different tools such as iHygiene and the descriptive tool. It is an easy to use it. In addition to that, related to design generators, which is related to engineering and prompts or prompts engineering in order to how to write the prompts in order to get high quality of the content. Audio, which is related to voice generators and the music generators. Actually, we did not use the music generators, just we are using in order to generate voice in order to add to Powtoon or to add it to the content created by the Canva. Also text generators, I think that everyone is using it, specifically ChatGPT 3.5 or 4, even brand or any other tools. In addition to that, we have code generators in order for the students who are learning programming and engineering and information technologies in general. In general, what type of tools that we are using for creating video is using Synthesia, which is a specific tool, and it is an important tool that we can use it. In addition to that, when you have a subscription, you can get a code in order to embed it in video. So it will be easy for you in order to embed the video. In addition to that, use it on the learning management system. What we are using for the learning management system at Al-Najah National University and most of the Palestinian higher education institutions are using Moodle, so it is easy to integrate it. So if you have using Synthesia and added to Hygiene in order to create a video or to generate video from the text from teachers, so it is easy. Just you need to go to have to make login, and it will be easy in order to have this tool. Okay. Just in order to create a free video, and so you'll go beyond this video. About enhancing teaching and learning with ChatGPT application, this is important that you can, everyone has a mobile, so it is easy for him. He can download ChatGPT for application from the maybe Apple Store or from Google Store. And the important thing that is supported getting pictures, specifically when I talk about uploading pictures and asking about to analyze the pictures, you need to make a subscription about ChatGPT 4. So we can use in order to enhance learning, in order you can record your voice on the applications in order to get instance of a message or to get any instance support from the applications. Using the to identify the equipment and tutorial, specifically when you are using it in the lab, in computer lab or in scientific lab, specifically when go to the students with the new equipments and in new instruments, just the student can take a picture from there by using their cell phones and started to use it in order to get information about these equipments and how we can get information about these equipments and how we can use it in their experiments. This will help for the faculty member and us for students to communicate with each other. I'm just okay. In order to have like a brainstorming creative uses of objectives, identify the same idea. It is like in order to use the ChatGPT application camera in order to get information about this. For example, like put this picture about this, how we, what about this, how we can use it, what type of experience that you suggested for us. So we provided many, many articles, many, many experiments. How can we use it in our in the scientific lab or in any science field? Here, in order to summarize the lectures, specifically when you are have some presentation or collaboration projects with the students they can start presenting their projects, and so just you can take a shot from your camera and ask the applications order to summarize the data in this screen or in the photos. We can focus only on the photo in general. And the same thing here about it is like about lectures or about video, about getting or summarizing the screen for the students. It is about a video about chemical reactions. So it is started to describe or to present example about the a presentation or about the screenshot of the video or from the screen. In general, ChatGPT, you are using sometimes about learning languages with other for the students who are not native English language or any other languages. So it is considered as a conversational learning, specifically by text through writing, or by using audio, using the new features in ChatGPT-4, which is easy to use and easy to get answers from the applications in general. So the students can acquire communication, can acquire new information, can develop their acquire new skills and information about the new skills that they need or looking for. As I said about the summarizing and assessment generation, which is important, some faculty members, they are using it in order to generate research questions through using GPT and create their courses. And then they can upload their, I will talk about it later, to upload their presentations and ask the tool in order to generate the questions for an exam or for any assignments to help them. This is which is the GPT. This is the features is available in ChatGPT-4. Just you need to subscribe around $20. And so you can create your online course an easy way just in order to go to explore GPT. So it will be appear this screen. So you can create your course in general. So you can go to configure, you can add your PowerPoint or your materials. And then you here can present it or preview the material in order for the student, and student can start using it. But how can we deliver this? It is easy in order just to click on save and then go to these 3 points and to make share of the of your course with your students or to make it public for everyone who can use it. And this is an important issue. So you don't need to design your syllabus or to design your course only on PowerPoint. Just you can to add it on ChatGPT for and to share it with your students. In addition to that, you can enable using the information on the application or you can disable it. It is up to you. It depends on the topic that you want to use. It depends on the, let's say, about the ethics that you will use in your course and about your privacy and the students' privacy in your course. So this is, I think this is important. We use it a lot in our university and then the Center of Artificial Intelligence and Virtual Reality Research Center. We are training teachers to use this in order to collect some data to know how faculty members are using these tools in order to enhance the learning process, in order to make accessibility for all the students. This is important for the accessibility. They can access it from their phone, cell phones, through when they have the link of this course or any tool that we are using. In addition to that, we can consider it is like cheap compared with other tools or other applications. This is about the generating of AI images or generating AI PowerPoint generation, which is important. Canva, we are using it in order for creating content for a lot of courses that we are using, because it have a lot of tools, a lot of features that we can integrate it in our courses, so it will be easy to make it more interactive for students and easy. In addition to that, it is free. But if you want to use additional features, yes, you can pay, but in general, we are using the free versions, which is, to be honest, I am using it for 3 years, which we are satisfied. And then after that, they added it or integrated with the generative AI about image generation and about video generation. In order to use these tools about generative AI, we should focus more about prompt engineering, which is related to the process of designing the effective prompts, the effective way that we need to write about to get information from the ChatGPT. In general, it has four elements about the prompt. The first one, it is related to the instruction, and then the context and the input-output indicators. In general, which is like a direct one, which is like, what is the capital of South Africa, for example. But later, this is what we call it a direct prompt. But if we need to get more information or specific information about this, about South Africa or Palestine, we have to write like a prompt in including instruction, including the context, the input in general. In order to, I will bring some of these in general. Okay, the design, I will go to four. Okay. When we are talking about using generative, it means that I need to write it in a long way. I mean, a long way, for example, I give it, okay, you are an expert in elementary teaching or in higher education teacher in science or in education. I am a special education teacher. Please provide me, for example, a lesson plan about teaching mathematics, for example, and including the criteria to assist for assessment students, including activities for special needs students who have some difficulties and so on. It means that I am giving it the applications, the directions in order to get a high quality of content, a high quality of lesson plan, or even about assessment in general. About the, we should take into consideration important consideration about using ChatGPT, especially when you are using it for education. The first one, it should be alignment with the educational standards. It means that about the standards that you are using in the top level in the country or the Ministry of Higher Education. In addition to that, it is important for the quality and accuracy of content. This is important. Yes, about generative AI, it can improve our teaching and learning. It can save our time and efforts. But the important thing, as we are users and educators, we should revise the final or the outputs of these tools. It means that to revise it, to make sure about the accuracy of the content of the information that we got, in addition to the should we have quality of it. The third one, it is related to bias and ethical consideration. And this is the important issue about the ethical consideration about using the applications. Just I'm talking about teaching, but what about if you are using it in scientific research? What about if I will not focus about using ChatGPT for in scientific research. I use it for proofreading. But what about if you are using another tool like Elsite or any other tools in order to generate a literature review or if you were using like AI Scopus, which is like a service that added by Elsevier in order to mitigate the difficulties that face the researchers in order to reduce their to increase their productivity about using the literature review. The important issue here, who is the owner of the idea of the research? Who is the owner of this information? The same thing in teaching and learning. When I ask the application in order to generate like assessment or generate exam questions, or even a lesson plan, who is the owner of this content? This is important. This is important issue that we need to focus. I agree that there are a lot of frameworks about using AI and the ethics of using it. But the majority of this framework will focusing about or about the development, about the development of these tools. But what about us, of us, about users? We are end users. We are teachers, we are educators. What are the framework of the ethical consideration that we have considered about using it? I think for me, when I talk about this and about lectures, I focus more about the educational standards. This is the important thing. Even the education system, it has its own ethics practices and ethics practices that we have to follow when we are teaching our students in public schools or in higher education. So I think this is important about using ethical consideration, about to have a framework clearly for the practitioners and for the educators in order to follow them. Educational objectives and pedagogical issues. This is another issue that all of us, we are talking about using educational technology, we know that we should change our pedagogical. And we should teach our teaching methods when you are using technology in general. What about using AI? This is important. We know it is easy to use it. We know it is easy to use it to increase your productivity, to integrate it with your activities inside the class or outside the class if you are using a flipped classroom or any other strategy. But the important issue is how we can make alignments between using these tools with our educational objectives and then without a pedagogical issue in general. So we have to look about a new teaching methods in order to integrate these tools in our practices. Data privacy and security, this is important. The good thing in generative AI that it does not focus more about collecting data from the students. It may be asked in order to register or to have account on the application or an AI platform. Well, but in general, we have to be more curious about how we can save students or the data that we get from our students, specifically when we are using it for assessments, especially when you are using Magic School or when you are using a class points in order to generate our exams in general. Accessibility and technical support. This is an important issue. In general, we are talking accessibility. That it means that we are going to have equity in education, equity between genders, equity between the areas, equity between North and South, and other things. In addition to that, in general, to be honest, using generative AI, it needs a lot of money. It means like a cost that a lot of money for higher education institutions. In addition to that, how can students use these tools? How can they use it in their own home and our homes? And not all of the students have internet to access to these tools. Moreover, technical support. Most of these applications are needs some technical support. In addition to that, I can say it about instructional support. Not only technical support, but also about instructional support, the course, which is important, just we need to focus more about it, the evaluation and feedback process that we need to provide our students and our users, and the context and cultural sensitivity, which is important in the specific context, specific culture, specific circumstances or environments that it is important to have to use some avoid using it in a bad way, and engagement in an interactive, which is important, how we can engage students in the activity in, generated by artificial intelligence, and what type of the interactive will happen in the with the students or the material or the applications. About the grading and feedback, this is important issue, which is like using grading, grade scope. I am sorry because I am using from another laptop, not it is for my son, this is not for me. So I need to go log in. I hope that I can log in. I hope that I am remembering the password. Just to show. I'm sorry, I don't remember my password. Okay, this I think this grad school is a best tool that we can use. Yes, it is like it depends on the size of the institution that they are using it, the description. But it can support them, can save time and efforts for teachers. Just you can not give the applications or the tool, the learning objectives, the material that you have, and then it asks you to ask it to generate the questions. And then you can publish for the students. In addition to that, it is the same system like Google Classroom in order to have a course so you can distribute the code of the class to your students, and so they can access it easily, and you can after that collect. The important point here, this application can work many things for you, can make data analysis for all of your students, which is this is important for, which is quite it about personalized learning, and to have like to know the needs of your students and the ability of your students. This is, I think, this is the actual tool that I used a lot of the applications in assessments and in our teaching in order to create content. But we found this is the best tool that we can use in order to analyze the data for our students, which it means that personalized learning and to understand of the students' needs and their ability in order to choose the learning materials based on these exams. This is the important one. And I think this is, we have supported it for many institutions in order to use it and ask students to use it. It does not ask students to have like account on it, just in order to send them their code and they go inside it and do their assessments or even their handwriting assignments, which this is important. The other one that we are using, which is like I said about ChatGPT-4, this is like about an electricity or about circuits in electricity, in order this is a handwriting assignment of the students just in order to make like a screen or to have a photo by using the camera on your phone and then ask it to create or to grade from 100 and provide feedback for the students. If get like a productive feedback and it like a strong feedback, and the faculty member after doing this go down and revise, because the tool it will be more restrictions and it will be strong, so you need to increase the grade of the students in order to be fair, because the students this is a class point, which is like an application that we can use in order to generate exams, generate questions about using it. It will be integrated into PowerPoint, and it is easy just in order to make it download on your laptop, and then it will be graded directly with PowerPoint, and so it is easy in order to create your exams. It is have a multiple of multiple choice with the cloud, short answer about drawing, about imaging, asking about fill in blanks, about audio record and video upload. And this is important, so it is easy in order to use it, but also this needs some subscription, and it paid for based on the number of the students. About scientific research, which is the important thing, how can we use generative AI tools for research? About generating ideas, about collaborative research, about using in order to for proofreading. To be honestly, I am using ChatGPT for proofreading, for and I write I like an arrangement about using it, because a lot of publishers started to accept using ChatGPT or generative AI in scientific research, but you have to claim and to make an arrangement how you use this in your research. In addition to that, Elsevier has launched its AI Scopus, which is like a service based on artificial intelligence in order to help researchers to write their literature review. These are some tools that you are, what type of tools you are using in your research. This is important. Here about the fields or domains that we can use AI for in scientific research, about generating text like Elsite, about data analysis, such as about using atlas.ai.com in order for qualitative data analysis, visualization of results, about using cloud for data analysis, multiple application proofreading ChatGPT, research management, which is called Bit AI, which is important, or when you have like some research or projects working with scholars from different countries in order to collaborate with them. There are a lot of applications that they are using in order to generate literature review and to help me, like connected papers, which is easy to just in order to have to click and to just in order to write about using Technostress. And let's say AI, maybe we can file so we can generate. It is an easy, okay, here, co-working with AI double sword in Technostress, so we can generate connected papers with this. So this is important. Here can visualize the information or the articles that I got in order to help me to write. This is important. This can reduce the time and the efforts that you need in order to look for articles. Look here, we have different circles with like bold, with like light colors, with small, with big. This has some meanings. The meaning for the light, it means that an old article is published in 2020. 2020, the light, the bold one, which is like a new one. Here the connected paper. The big one, it means that it has a lot of citations. Look here, around 148 citations. This is important. In addition to that, we have like prior research about this. About this, can list give you a list of articles before this time, or derivative research based on the items that I got here, 2023. This is important, can help us in order to get a big number of articles on the platform, so it is easy for me to, in order to start looking for these articles and start generating or writing my literature review. In addition to that, we have another tool for scientific research, which is, I think it is close to it, but it is more professional, which is like Elsite, which is important for me. And this is, I can No synchronous, okay, which is good. Okay, the same thing, take no stress. And AI. Just here can give me, I can put like filtering what type of article that I want. So here the paper, the title of the paper, here the abstract summary generated by the applications, and here what I can add, and this is important. It depends on my the main findings, for example, or about the methodology, or about the interventions, or so on. It depends on the number that what I'm looking for. This is important for me in order to reduce the time. Look here, what we are getting. The paper, abstract summary, and main findings, the methodology that we are using, it depends about methodology, quantitative, involves creating using critical, not mentioned here, not applicable, the methodology, and so on. Here it is can easy for us in order to know what type of articles. I think this is important. We can use in systematic review. If I need to conduct a study about systematic review, I can use this application, and it is easy to use it and free. Also, we have another applications. Yes, sorry. Connected paper, okay. Ila site, and either this is the important one, which is like a platform. This is a platform, this is important, so it is easy, you can use it, but it has some restrictions on some services on it, so you need to pay, but it is important, so we can make a proofreading for your, for the research, for example, just in order to access to it, okay. Okay, so maybe it's have some question. You can make a proofreading. You can wait for citation checker for about the similarities checker or plagiarism checker. Journal finder, this is an important thing that we can, after finishing our manuscript, writing it, we can ask for a journal to find a journal, suitable journal based on the findings for my research. Okay, this is about how using, how we can use AI in general. This is the life cycle of artificial intelligence to start about knowing and understanding, then about using applications, AI ethics, and evaluate and create your final products, which is related maybe writing articles, proofreading, or creating content, or improving existing content, or designing your assignments. Here about how we can use it, the scientific research in preparations, initiation, data analysis using some applications in qualitative, about writing the discussion and proofreading. The proofreading process, it is easy, so it is, you can save your money. You can just by using ChatGPT-4 and so you can make a proofreading when organizing your research. The concern that we have about using in teaching and scientific research is related to heavy reliance on using these tools in order to create the content, or to write a literature review or for proofreading. In addition to that, the plagiarism or similarities, specifically when you are using AI detections. Previously, 10N does not detect AI, but these days, no, it can detect it, but it has some, which is like mistakes in it, loss of creativity and authorship. So all of the publishers, they're not allowed to write generative AI or AI as a co-author in your paper. The services that we are using for in our in using generative AI, there are a lot of services. as I mentioned in the beginning, using it for emotional support during hard time for students and faculty member, in order to use it, some application that it can, students use it in order to communicate with it, in order to use it, but to be honest, we use it in a limited time for students and with Gaza, but in West Bank, yes, we are using it because the people there are looking for food, not looking for eat, for looking for teaching or learning, because they don't have access to internet or even electricity, but we can use for other faculty members or for the students in West Bank in order to have to emotional support by using these tools. Okay. This is the application that we are there using in order to have for services for getting fund or getting, this is the applications which is called, so, which is called HyperWrite, which is have more than 100 applications that we can use it in order to improve the services that we are giving for writing fundraising or for writing emails or anything. Okay, thank you so much. I hope that you enjoyed my lecture, and I am happy to answer your questions.
Thank you so much. There was conversation about using different generative AI and Canva and a lot of those. But I'm just wondering, amongst the challenges that are there in the use of generative AI, which one is the highest challenge in education? What comes up more often in education?
Yes. Thank you so much for this question. I based on our experience, the big challenge for using generative AI, it is continuous upgrading and updating. Do you understand me? It means that a lot of tools that they are updating and upgrading. And when we have like a guidelines for using and for supporting educators or having like a professional development sessions, they ask, no, I'm using another one, another application. I am using another tool. So this is the big challenge for educators. I think this is for the decision makers in order to choose what is the best one and to have the professional development. There are some issues like related to the cost, but when you have like fund, yes, you can mitigate this. The second order for the challenges is the instructional support. How they can integrate these tools in their practices, how they can engage their students and give their feedback online. We are talking about a specific area. We are talking about a specific area where there is no electricity, or there is a lack of electricity and there is a lack of equipments such as internet. This is, I think, the challenges. Maybe these challenges will be different for the another context or for other country or other area in the world.
Thank you so much for your response. I think we will keep on having challenges as far as technology is concerned, and we have to deal with them as we go on. But it's always nice when you come in and make us look at it in a very different perspective. I do know that we are over the hour by 7 minutes, but I would encourage you to stay on for a few more minutes.
Sure, I am here, so.
Yes, and also the participants, just to have a conversation. So I open the floor to anyone. You can raise your hand and take the mic, or just type your question in the chat if you have a question. Please do feel free to take the mic and ask your question.
Good afternoon. My name is Jama. I just have one question. In relation to the process of going through all this, did your university start by putting up a policy or just left free? Like you just go, use whatever it is there teachers can use. There's no policy at the university. How was the process?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for this request, for your questions. Yes, there is a policy. Each faculty member should write his own policy in his courses. This is which is called an individual level for the faculty member. The second level, it is like, it is okay. Faculty member, there is the rules and the policy. They can use it for the students and it is open for the students to use it. But if you use it in your exams and your assignments by copy and paste without editing, you will be considered as cheating. And this is a clear point for all the students and on the system. Yes, you can use it. This is intent for, yes, we have a clear policy about started about training faculty members. We started last year in 2023. I think we, like these days, all of the summer we were using it. There are like some fund in order to buy some specific tools that will be recommended by the decision makers by conducting focus group sessions with faculty members from different faculties, I mean from education, social sciences, engineering, and medicine, in order to suggest the best tools that meet their requirements for teaching and training. For this reason, for example, in medicine, we have like which is called a virtual lab, which is supported by AI. And for this is for training students in medicine. And this is the policy was adapted for the all that students to use it and faculty members. This was guided, to be honest, by using the guidelines of the UNESCO and by using the European countries framework that we use in order to lead us or to guide us to put the policy in our university.
Thank you, thank you. Another question.
Sure.
From the apps which are available free to use or the apps which are paid for use, from your experience, which ones they can provide, they are providing better performance?
Yeah, thank you so much. For using assessments, we are using two tools. The first one, GradeScore and ClassBot, which is important because it is easy for us to integrate with the learning management system. For us, we are teaching online since October 7, okay? So this is important. In the online learning system, we are using Moodle. So all the presentations, all the lectures are on Zoom. So all of the assignments are on Moodle. So it is important when we are looking for a specific or the best performance that can meet our needs and our requirements in our specific context, we found these two tools important for assessments and Canva for creating and for the productivity, for the creation of the content, because it is easy and it is free. In addition to the specific services that we get from GradeScore that can make data analysis of the students, so faculty members, it is easy for them to get like a clear picture about the performance of his students. We use another tools, which is like, but it is a new tools, which is related to virtual reality, where they're supported by AI. I think this is from a new company, which is called EE on VR. Just another thing. Yes, this is, okay. Did you see my screen now?
Yes.
Yes,
Okay.
yes, yes.
Yeah, yes.
this is a new tool as we started to, just like I have a communication with the owners with this platform in order to use it in order to get like a broader knowledge and information specifically for medicine education and computer and engineering educations, because it's more suitable for these scientific fields more than social sciences. This just we are starting in order to explore this in order to integrate training some faculty members. We have like limited access to it for specific people in order to explore this. And or maybe which will be productive, or well, we don't know until now about it. Any questions? Thank you so much, Irene. Thank you.
I'm thinking that because we have different resources that are available to us in different continents and different countries.
Yeah.
Do you feel that if we are open as lecturers and as faculty in higher education, or even in education generally, if we are open, that some of this AI, this generative AI, will make our work much easier than if we are concerned about it, you know, in terms of plagiarism, in terms of creativity, in terms of that. If we embrace it, do you think it's going to make our work easier in relation to you know, our teaching?
Yeah, I think so. Yes, we can. If we have like an open AI sources, I think this will be good. I think it will be when we have a collaborative projects between higher education institutions, let's say in Palestine and South Africa, in order to share their knowledge and skills, in order to share the content that generated by AI to teach our students, I think it will be easy. I don't think so that AI will reduce the creativity to reduce, or let's say the good or the quality of work. No, I think, let's say when we are using AI or generative AI in scientific research, we will get a high quality about research. We will get high quality and high productivity for scientific research, and it will be reduce the efforts and time for us. But this should be like under a clear policy, under a clear vision from the higher education institutions, a clear framework that can make collaborative easy and easier for all the faculty members in order to collaborate and to share their knowledge and to share the content. One day we will use AI as an important source, an important tool, important platform in order to have a collaborative projects and to support online in general. And I think this is important. Maybe this month, next month, we will see some announcements. We will see some advertisement for new jobs that you have at least a knowledge about using generative AI. We prefer the person who have skills to write prompts on using generative AI. I think this is important. And this, I think this is important to have to establish new projects to collaborate using generative AI in education and in teaching specifically. In research, we are using it. We have a lot of research groups worldwide using it in research in order to increase the productivity. But until now, about teaching and learning, there are some challenges, something related to the instructional support, something related to the course, something related to the policy in some countries, they don't allow to use AI in general.
Wow. I'm excited. I'm happy. I'm fulfilled, really. I'm grateful that you are with us. But I'll let Mohammed, Dr. Mohammed, to say the final words before we close the session. And kindly send your feedback about the session with, in the link that we have provided. Dr. Mohammed, are you there for the vote of thanks? I had seen him in the I had seen him earlier. I don't know if he can hear me. Anyway, probably can't hear me. You know, we have lots of challenges. So I'm grateful that you are here, Dr. Zuhair. I know the challenges that we go through and you're going through, especially in whatever is happening in your country. But we are so grateful that you could make the time and you could join us today to give us this insight into just using AI in education. And we have learned a lot. I have promised people that we are going to share your slides. So please share them with us so that we can share when we are sharing the recording and anything else that came up. And we appreciate you. We hope that we can collaborate again so that we can have the two sides of the coin, where we have you from the Arab world and we can have the other side. And, you know, we can compare notes and see how we are doing if generative AI in English is better than in Arabic, and Arabic. See how we
sure,
can
yeah,
work
yeah.
On that. Yes.
This is
and
important.
See.
Excuse me, sorry. For generative, unfortunately, for generative in Arabic language, I have a lecture next Wednesday about using generative AI in Arabic language. Unfortunately, most of the applications are not supporting Arabic language, and this will be the biggest challenge for schools. Because
yeah.
Higher education did not have any problem about this, about language. But for schools, because, you know, kids, Arabic language, religion, teaching in Arabic language, it will be a big challenge for them to use these tools. So it means we have to look about our own applications that support our own language.
I think, will it be in English or in Arabic?
The session that is upcoming. It will be an Arabic language.
Perhaps you could do another one in English in the future. We'll talk about it and see.
Because this organized by a university and Arabic language department. How we can utilize technology in teaching Arabic? This is important.
Yes. I think this is very important and we need to keep on the collaborations going.
Sure.
Because the insights and the perspectives that each side has is really key to making generative AI work for us, not against us. So I am grateful for your time. I'm grateful for everybody who came in earlier and waited. And you're still here. We appreciate you. We know that your time is important. And we are grateful. We'll be sharing all the resources that are, we have shared now. So thank you, everyone. Give
thank
us
you.
Your feedback and see you in our next session, which we'll be sharing with you in the coming weeks. Thank you, everyone.
Thank
and
you
bye
so
for
much.
Now.
Have a nice day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.